أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. لقد أرسلنا رسلنا بالبينات وأنزلنا معهم الكتاب والميزان ليقوم الناس بالقسط. صدق الله العظيم.
هو نصلي على رسوله الكريم. أما بعد, we are going to start today inshallah at Surah Al-Fath. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إنا فتحنا لك فتحا مبينا ليغفر لك الله ما تقدم من ذنبك وما تأخر ويتم نعمته عليك ويهديك صراطا مستقيما وينصرك الله نصرا عزيزا. هو الذي أنزل السكينة في قلوب المؤمنين ليزدادوا إيمانا مع إيمانهم ولله جنود السماوات والأرض وكان الله عليما حكيما. صدق الله العظيم. The second Madani Surah of this group is Surah Al-Fath. The first was Surah Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam or Surah Al-Qital. Now the timings of their revelation are very important. Surah Al-Qital or Surah Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was revealed when the armed conflict phase was going to start. It was the beginning of the Qital fi sabilillah. And the Surah Fatah was revealed in the sixth year after Hijrah, when we may say that a 4 years war had come to some end, meaning thereby that the Kufr had understood that now they are no match for Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Therefore they had to, and they were forced to, make a treaty with Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala declared as a clear victory, Sulh Hudaybiyah. Now the historical background is that Ghazwatul Ahzab, it took place in the fifth year after Hijrah. And after that battle of Ahzab, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has said to the Muslims that this was the last time that the Quraysh could dare to come and attack us. Now they will not be able to take this initiative. Now the initiative will be from our side. لَنْ يَغْزُوكُمْ قُرَيْشْ بَعْدَ عَامِكُمْ هَذَا وَلَكِنَّكُمْ تَغْزُونَهُمْ. Quraysh are not going to invade you, attack you after this year of yours. Now we shall take the initiative. So after that, he saw a dream, a vision. And the dream and vision of a prophet is also wahi, but wahi khafi. That is, not loud wahi, not jali wahi, but silent wahi, inspiration. To wahi ya jali we call revelation, because it is verbal. The whole message comes with the wordings given by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself. But inspiration is the English word for wahi khafi. Some idea comes to the mind or heart of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He expresses it with his own words. The words are not divine. The words are from Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is called wahi khafi. We may call them the silent wahi. So he saw a, you know, dream that he and the Muslims, they were performing Umrah. So he declared. As I told you, wahi of a prophet is also this khab, this vision and dream of a prophet is also wahi. So much so that Hazrat Ibrahim alayhi salatu was ready to sacrifice his son the only son. Till that time he was the only son. Ishaq came later, alayhi salatu wasalam, only on the basis of the vision. So now, the Prophet sent a call to all people that I am going to Umrah, perform Umrah. Now whosoever can come should go with me. About 1400 people accompanied him. According to certain traditions, the number was 1800. Somewhere between 1400 and 1800. When they reached there and the news came to the Quraysh of Makkah, they were very furious. We are never going to let Muhammad and his companions make Umrah here. So the position came very tense. And there was some negotiation going on. Hazrat Usman radiallahu ta'ala anhu was sent, but he was detained there due to some reasons. And then the rumor spread that he was killed, sallallahu radiallahu anhu. On that, the Prophet took the bayah from the Muslims who were present there. This is called Bayatul Rizwan, because it is mentioned in the surah, radiallahu anil mu'mineen, is yubayyunaka tahta shajara. So Bayatul Rizwan, it is called also bayah al-maut. The bayah was that we shall not go back from here, though every one of us is killed here. Bay'a al maut. But when these news reached Makkah, now they were perturbed. The resolution, you know, determination on the part of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the mu'mineen, the believers. So then some negotiations started, and a treaty was concluded, which is called the Treaty of Hudaybiyah. It was in a way degrading to the Muslims, because the first condition was that this year you have to go back without performing Umrah. But the next year you can come. We shall vacate the Quraysh of Makkah said, we shall vacate Makkah for 3 days for you. We shall go to the mountains. You perform the rites of Umrah at peace. But this year you have to go back. And then it was a treaty for 10 years, that there should be peace between us, no fight, no battle. And whosoever of the tribes of that area wanted, they could become party to the Quraysh. Whosoever wanted, they could become the partners of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So in this way, another thing which was degrading for Muslims was that if a Muslim escapes, for example, a Muslim in Makkah, he has come to believe, and his parents, they have tied him in chains. Somehow he breaks the chains and he comes to Medina, but Muslims will have to send him back. But if someone comes from Medina to Makkah, we will not be forced or obliged to send him back. So two things were there which were unequal. So the Muslims as a whole, they were not happy at this treaty. Why are we making this treaty as the weaker party? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us strength. We can fight them. Why should we bow down? But the Prophet said, I am doing what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has commanded me to do. When this treaty was concluded, then these ayat were revealed. And the immediate result of this treaty was that when Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was fully secure from the southern part, southern side, from Makkan side, then he invaded Khaybar, which was to the north of Medina, conquered Khaybar. And it brought a lot of, you know, booty and wealth to the Muslims, so that the Muslims became well-to-do, all of them. So this was the first result. That is the conquest of Khaybar. The second result was that when there was peace, the missionary dawah activity, it increased and intensified. The Prophet intensified his dawah and missionary activity. And secondly, because, you know, the tribes of the Arabia, they saw that Quraysh had to make a treaty with Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. What does it mean? It means they have recognized Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When you conclude a treaty with some party, you recognize him. So it means that now they feel that Muhammad is a power to reckon with. So now there was a wave, people accepting Islam. So this was the second fruit of this treaty. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Inna fatahna laka fatham mubina. We have granted you, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, a very clear and manifest victory. لِيَغْفِرَ لَكَ اللَّهُ مَا تَقَدَّمَ مِنْ ذَنْبِكَ وَمَا تَأَخَّرَ. So that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala should compensate for you any of your shortcomings, whether previous or later. I am translating zamb. It's not sin. This word we can't use for Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Shortcomings. And he now completes and perfects his blessing over you. وَيَهْدِيَكَ صِرَاطَ مُسْتَقِيمًا, and guides you to the straight way. And I understand with this that now guides your struggle to establish the deen of Allah in a very straight line. Now the road is open. وَيَنْصُرَكَ اللَّهُ نَصْرًا عَزِيزًا, and so that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala helps you with a mighty help. هُوَ الَّذِي أَنزَلَ السَّكِينَةَ فِي قُلُوبِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. It is He who sent down the calm in the hearts of the believers, because they were not happy, but still, because the Prophet was doing it, they took it. That was a discipline. And this was due to the calm that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has sent down in their hearts. لِيَزْدَادُوا إِيمَانًا مَعَ إِيمَانِهِمْ, so that they should have more faith in addition to the faith that they already had. وَلِلَّهِ جُنُودُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ, to Allah belong the armies and hosts of the heavens and the earth. وَكَانَ اللَّهُ عَلِيمًا حَكِيمًا, and verily Allah is all-knowing, all-wise. لِيُدْخِلَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ وَالْمُؤْمِنَاتِ جَنَّاتٍ تَجْرِي مِنْ تَحْتِ الْأَنْهَارِ, so that he should admit the believer men and the believing women gardens underneath which rivers will be flowing. وَيُكَفِّرَ عَنْهُمْ سَيِّئَاتِهِمْ, and acquit them of their evil deeds. وَكَانَ ذَلِكَ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ فَوْزًا عَظِيمًا, and with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is a very big triumph. وَيُعَذِّبَ الْمُنَافِقِينَ وَالْمُنَافِقَاتِ, and so that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chastises the hypocrite men and women, وَالْمُشْرِكِينَ وَالْمُشْرِكَاتِ, and those men and women who associate with Allah false gods. الظانين بالله ظن السوء, who think about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala evil thoughts. عليهم دائرة السوء, against them shall be the evil turn of misfortune. وغضب الله عليهم, and Allah will be angry upon them. ولعنهم وعد لهم جهنم, and He will curse them and He will prepare for them the hell, wasaat masira, and it's a very evil destination. Actually, the munafiqeen at that time, they thought that it's a big blunder that Muhammad is committing, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They withheld. They did not go with Muhammad, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Only the mu'mineen sadiqeen went. The munafiqeen thought, he's going. Where he's going? He wants to meet Quraysh, and also at Makkah, so they will never be able to return. This is given in further in the ayat, you'll find this. They thought they will all be finished. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and all the Muslims who are going, you know, they will all be finished by Quraysh. So that was within their hearts. وَلِلَّهِ جَنُودُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ, to Allah belong all the hosts and armies of the heavens and the earth. وَكَانَ اللَّهُ عَزِيزًا حَكِيمًا, and Allah is ever mighty, wise. إِنَّا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ شَاهِدًا وَمُبَشِّرًا وَنَزِيرًا. We have sent you, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as a witness and bearer of the glad tidings and a warner. لِتُؤْمِنُوا بِاللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ, so that you, O believers, have real faith in Allah and His Messenger. وَتُعَزِّرُوهُ وَتُوَقِّرُوهُ, And you help the messenger and honor him. وَتُصَبِّحُوهُ بُكْرَةً وَأَصِيلًا. And you glorify Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the mornings as well as the evenings. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يُبَايَعُونَكَ إِنَّمَا يُبَايَعُونَ اللَّهِ. Verily, those who are pledging themselves to you, actually they are pledging themselves to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now this is the bay'ah. What is bay'ah? The root is bay'ah. Bay'ah means to sell. Bay'ah, to sell. So actually, iman, when a person says, I accept Allah as my Lord, it is as if he has sold himself to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the price he will get in the hereafter, and that is Jannah. Now this, whatever he has, his life and his belongings, are a trust with him. He had already sold them. So whenever, whosoever has purchased, he can demand, bring forth, give me. But who will demand on behalf of Allah? It was the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So the bay was, the sale was between the mu'min and Allah. But on behalf of Allah, it was the position of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam to demand them to come and expend their lives and their wealth in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So now this was the bay. A person, you know, had to put his hand over the head of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and pledge himself. But Allah here says that actual bay he is doing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because bay is between the believer and Allah. So what is, this is what is said here. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يُبَايَعُونَكَ. Verily, those who are pledging themselves, giving their bay'ah to you, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, إِنَّمَا يُبَايَعُونَ اللَّهِ. Verily, they are pledging themselves and selling themselves to Allah. يَدُ اللَّهِ فَوْقَ أَيْدِيهِمْ. I call this a tripartite agreement. There are three parties. Hand of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. On this comes the hand of the believer, mu'min, who is pledging himself. Allah says there is another hand, third hand of Allah, above it, but it is invisible. Yadullahi fawqa aydihim. The hand of Allah is there, over their hands. Faman nakasa. Now whosoever breaks this pledge, fainnama yankusu ala nafsi. So he will break it to his own loss. Faman awfa bima ahada alayhu Allah. And whosoever fulfills whatever he has made covenant with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for, فَسَيُوتِهِ أَجْرٌ عَظِيمًا. To him Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give a very mighty reward. سَيَقُولُ لَكَ الْمُخَلَّفُونَ مِنَ الْعَرَابِ. Now this second section, that is referring to when the Prophet came back and he was going back to Medina after concluding the treaty. Now those things, those munafiqeen, they were thinking that he will never be able to come back. It's finished. The whole game is finished. And here Muhammad is coming, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in a way victorious. Because the Quraysh had acknowledged him, recognized him, that he's a power to reckon with. سَيَقُولُ لَكَ الْمُخَلَّفُونَ مِنَ الْعَرَابِ. Now when you return to them, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the desert Arabs who were left behind, who didn't join you, they will say, O Prophet, شَغَلَكْنَا أَمْوَالُنَا وَأَهْلُونَا. Our possessions and our families kept us occupied. That is why we couldn't go with you. فَاسْتَغْفِرْ لَنَا. So ask Allah's forgiveness for us. يَقُولُونَ بِأَلْسِنَتِهِمْ. They are saying with their tongues, مَا لَيْسَ فِي قُلُوبِهِمْ. What is not there in their hearts. قُلْ فَمَنْ يَمْلِكُ لَكُمْ مِنَ اللَّهِ شَيْئًا. Ask them, who can avail anything against Allah if he intends to do you any harm? In arada bikum dharran. If somebody says, okay, my wife was very sick, I couldn't go with you, but could you cure your wife if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has decreed death for your wife? Or could not Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give her the health without you? It's a matter of conviction. فَمَنْ يَمْلِكُ لَكُمْ مِنَ اللَّهِ شَيْءٍ إِنْ أَرَادَ بِكُمْ ضَرًّا. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has decided something evil for you, so who has the authority to stop him? How or rather become nafa? If he has decided for you something good, so who can stop him? بَلْكَانَ اللَّهُ بِمَا تَعْمَلُونَ خَبِيرًا. What you were doing, Allah was very much aware of it. بَلْ ذَنَنْتُمْ. Now this is what was there in heart in this next ayah. بَلْ ذَنَنْتُمْ أَنْ لَنْ يَنْقَلِبَ الرَّسُولَ وَالْمُؤْمِنُونَ إِلَىٰ أَهْلِهِمْ أَبَدًا. Actually you thought that the messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the believers would never return alive to their families. They are doomed. The game is finished. وَزُوِيِّنَ ذَلِكَ فِي قُلُوبِكُمْ. And this idea was made beautiful in your hearts. وَزَنَنْتُمْ ذَنَّ السَّوْءِ. And you had guessed an evil guess. وَكُنْتُمْ قَوْمًا بُورًا. And definitely, you are a people ruined. وَمَنْ لَمْ يُؤْمِنْ بِاللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ فَإِنَّا أَعْتَدْنَا لِلْكَافِرِينَ سَعِيرًا. Whosoever doesn't believe in Allah and His Messenger, so we have for such disbelievers, we have prepared a blazing fire. وَلِلَّهِ مُلْكُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. To Allah belongs the kingdom and sovereignty of the heavens and the earth. يَغْفِرُ لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ وَيُعَذِّبُ مَنْ يَشَاءُ. He will forgive whomsoever He wills and chastise whomsoever He wills. وَكَانَ اللَّهُ غَفُورًا رَحِيمًا. And verily Allah is Ghafoor and Rahim, forgiving and merciful. سَيَقُولَ الْمُخَلَّفُونَ إِذْ انْطَلَقْتُمْ إِلَىٰ مَغَانِمَ لِتَأْخُذُوهَا ذَرُونَا نَتَّبِعْكُمْ. Now when the Prophet decided to launch an attack on Khaybar, now these munafiqeen also said that we should go with him. You see, it seems that the tides have turned and Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will conquer Khaybar. And then there will be lot of ghanima, lot of booty. So we also want to go with you to Khaybar. سَيَقُولَ الْمُخَلَّفُونَ. Very soon those who were left behind during the Sulah Hudaybiyah, they didn't go there for Umrah. When you set forth to take spoils, this is referring to the expedition of Khaybar. لِتَأْخُذُوهَا ذَرُونَا نَتَّبِعْكُمْ. Allow us, permit us to go with you. فَذَلِكُمْ قَالَ اللَّهُ مِنْ قَبْلُ. قُلْ لَمْ تَتَّبِعُونَا يُرِيدُونَ أَنْ يُبَدَّلُوا كَلَامَ اللَّهِ. They want to change the decision of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. قُلْ لَمْ تَتَّبِعُونَا كَذَلِكُمْ قَالَ اللَّهُ مِنْ قَبْلُ. Allah has already said that you will not go with us. فَسَيَقُولُونَ بَلْ تَحْسُدُونَنَا. They will say you are jealous of us. بَلْ كَانُوا لَا يَفْقَهُونَ إِلَّا قَلِيلًا. But the reality is that they understand not but a little. They wanted to go to Khaybar, but it was declared that only those will accompany the Messenger of Allah towards Khaybar who had gone with the intention of Umrah to Makkah. No else, nobody else will be able to accompany him. قُلْ لِلْمُخَلَّفِينَ مِنَ الْأَعْرَابِ. O Prophet, said to these people who were left behind from among the desert dwellers, سَتُدْعَوْنَ إِلَىٰ قَوْمٍ أُلِي بَاسٍ شَدِيدٍ. Very soon you will be called to fight against a nation having a great might of war. تُقَاتِلُونَهُمْ أَوْ يُسْلِمُونَ. Either you will go against them in fighting or they will surrender. فَإِنْ تُطِيعُوا يُوتِكُمُ اللَّهُ أَجْرًا حَسَنًا. At that time, if you obey, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give you very good reward. وَإِن تَتَوَلَّوْا كَمَا تَوَلَّيْتُمْ مِنْ قَبْلِ. And if you will turn your backs as you turned your backs before, يُعَذِّبْكُمْ عَذَابًا أَلِيمًا. Allah will chastise you with a very painful chastise. Most of the interpreters, they say that this refers to the journey of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to Tabuk, when there was a confrontation between the Prophet of Allah on the one side and the Roman Empire on the other side. Now there was call for everyone to accompany him. So it is referring to this. A time will come when your iman will be again tested. And if you turn your backs at that time also, just as you turn your backs at the eve of this Sulah Hudaybiyah, the Treaty of Hudaybiyah, then you know you'll be chastised. لَيْسَ عَلَى الْأَعْمَى حَرَجٌ. There is no blame on the blind. وَلَا عَلَى الْعَرَجِ حَرَجٌ. Nor there is any blame on the lame. وَلَا عَلَى الْمَرِيزِ حَرَجٌ. nor there is any blame on someone who is sick. وَمَنْ يُطِعِ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ Whosoever obeys Allah and His Messenger, يُدْخِلُهُ جَنَّاتٍ تَجْرِي مِنْ تَحْتِهَا الْأَنْهَارُ He will make them enter the gardens underneath which rivers will be flowing. وَمَنْ يَتَوَلَّبْ And whosoever turns his back, يُعَذِّبْهُ عَذَابًا أَلِيمًا He will chastise them, he will chastise him with a painful chastisement. لَقَدْ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ Verily Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was pleased with the believers. Is يُبَايِعُونَكَ تَحْتَ الشَّجَرَةِ When they were giving you, O Muhammad, their bayah under that tree. A small tree was there. The Prophet sat under the shade of that tree. And then the people coming one by one and giving their bayah to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is called Bayatul Rizwan. 1400 or 1800 people gave their bayah to him. فَعْلِمَ مَا فِي قُلُوبِهِمْ Allah very well knew what was there in their hearts. Because till that time, treaty had not been concluded. And the rumor was that Hazrat Usman radiallahu ta'ala anhu has been murdered. So it was to take an avenge. And this bayah was for fighting. Bayah al-maut. No one of us will go from here, turn his back from the battlefield, although we might be killed, all of us. So what was in their hearts, you know? The iman, and you know, the love of martyrdom, whatever you, how you pronounce it. لَقَدْ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ اَذْ يُبَايِعُونَكَ تَحْتَ الشَّجَرَةِ فَعَلِمَ مَا فِي قُلُوبِهِمْ فَأَنزَلَ السَّكِينَةَ عَلَيْهِمْ So he sent down calm on them. وَأَصَابَهُمْ فَتْحًا قَرِيبًا And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then rewarded them with a very near treaty. Now this near treaty is either number one, the treaty himself, near victory. Either it is the treaty of Hudaybiyah or this is the victory of Khaybar, which is referred here. وَمَغَانِمَ كَثِيرَةً And lot of spoils, يَأْخُذُونَهَا, which they will take. وَكَانَ اللَّهُ عَزِيزًا حَكِيمًا And verily Allah is all-powerful and all-wise. وَعَدَكُمُ اللَّهُ مَغَانِمَ كَثِيرَةً تَأْخُذُونَهَا Allah has promised you more spoils that you will capture. And فَعَجَّلَ لَكُمْ هَذِهِ And this victory at Hudaybiyah, he has hastened to you. وَكَفَّ أَيْدِيَ النَّاسِ عَنْكُمْ He withheld the hands of the people from you. لِتَكُونَ آيَةً لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ So that this becomes a sign of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the believers. وَيَهْدِيَكُمْ صِرَاطًا مُسْتَقِيمًا So that he guides you to the right path. وَأُخْرَى لَمْ تَخْدَرُوهَا And other victory also, which you have not been able to achieve up till now. لَمْ تَخْدِرُوهَا لَمْ تَخْدِرُوا عَلَيْهَا قَدْ أَحَاطَ اللَّهُ بِهَا But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has encompassed it. وَكَانَ اللَّهُ عَلَىٰ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرًا And verily Allah is powerful over everything. This is the conquest of Khaybar. وَلَوْ قَاتَلَكُمُ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا Had these disbelievers of Makkah fought you, لَوَلَّهُ الْأَدْوَارِ They must have turned their backs to you. ثُمَّ لَا يَجِدُونَ وَلِيًّا وَلَا نَصِيرًا And they would not have found after that for them any protector nor any helper. سُنَّةَ اللَّهِ الَّتِي قَدْ خَلَتْ مِنْ قَبْلِ And this is the rule and practice of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala which has been there for all those people who were before. وَلَن تَجِدَ لِسُنَّةِ اللَّهِ تَبْعِيلًا And you won't find for the practices of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala any change. وَهُوَ الَّذِي كَفَّ أَيْدِيَهُمْ عَنْكُمْ And it is He who withheld your hands from them, وَأَيْدِيَكُمْ عَنْهُمْ وَأَيْدِيَهُمْ عَنْكُمْ Their hands from you and your hands from them, بِبَطْنِ مَكَّةَ In the valley of Makkah, مِنْ بَعْدِ أَنْ أَسْفَرَكُمْ عَلَيْهِمْ Although He had granted you victory over them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't want that there should be a fight, there should be a battle at that time. And there are coming, you know, what was the reason? This is given in the next ayah. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, He stopped the hands of the kuffar and stopped the hands of the Muslims. So no fighting. Why? فَكَانَ اللَّهُ بِمَا تَعْمَلُونَ بَصِيرًا And whatever you were doing, Allah was seeing it. هم الذين كفروا وصدوكم عن المسجد الحرام. It is they who have disbelieved, number one. وصدوكم عن المسجد الحرام, and who have stopped you from the sacred mosque, number two. These are the crimes of the people of Makkah. وَالْهَدِيَ مَعَكُوفًا, and the offering, the sacrifices, they are also being withheld from reaching its place, that is Makkah. أَنْ يَبْلُغَ مَحِلَّهُ وَلَوْلَا رِجَالٌ مُؤْمِنُونَ وَنِسَاءٌ مُؤْمِنَاتٌ. If there were no believing men and women in Makkah, لَمْ تَعْلَمُوهُمْ, whom you didn't know, أَنْ تَتَوُوهُمْ, there was every possibility that you would have trampled on them. When there is war, whosoever was in Makkah, you would have taken them to the kafirs, to unbelievers. They might have been killed at your hands. While they were Muslims, they couldn't make hijrah. They couldn't come to Makkah. They didn't have the means to travel to Makkah, for example. لَوْلَا رِجَالٌ مُؤْمِنُونَ وَنِسَاءٌ مُؤْمِنَاتٌ. If there were not the believing men and women, لَمْ تَعْلَمُوهُمْ, whom you didn't know, أَنْ تَتَوُوهُمْ, there was a possibility that you would have trampled over them. فَتُصِيبَكُمْ مِنْهُمْ عَوْرَةً بِغَيْرِ عِلْمٍ, and thus there might befall upon you a guilt unknowingly. If that was not the case, we would have given you the clear victory after fighting. But we stopped fighting here. لَيُدْخِلِ اللَّهُ فِي رَحْمَتِهِ مَنْ يَشَاءُ, so that Allah admits to His mercy whomsoever He likes. لَوْ تَزَيَّلُوا, if those Muslim and Mu'min women and men had separated themselves from these kuffar, absolutely, لَوْ تَزَيَّلُوا لَعَذَّبْنَا الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا مِنْهُمْ عَذَابًا أَلِيمًا, we would have chastised these unbelievers at this very moment with a very painful chastisement. But because they were mixed, and it was every possibility that they would have been killed. إِذْ جَعَلَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا فِي قُلُوبِهِمْ حَمِيَّةَ الْجَاهِلِيَّةِ, when those who disbelieved had set up in their hearts pride and haughtiness of the pagan ignorance. فَأَنزَلَ اللَّهُ سَكِينَتَهُ عَلَىٰ رَسُولِهِ, but Allah sent down His calm and tranquility over His messenger and over the believers. وَأَلْزَمَهُمْ كَلِمَةَ التَّقْوَىٰ, and made them stick to the word of piety. وَكَانُوا أَحَقَّ بِهَا وَأَهْلَهَا, for they had better right of it and they were worthy of it. وَكَانَ اللَّهُ بِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ عَلِيمًا, and definitely Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows everything. لَقَدْ صَدَقَ اللَّهُ رَسُولَهُ الرُّيَا بِالْحَقِّ, verily Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had shown His messenger a true vision. It was not wrong. Some people said, O Prophet, you said that you saw in the vision that we are performing Umrah, and now we are going without performing Umrah. So Allah is giving this answer. Only it has been delayed. Otherwise, the vision is absolutely correct. And you know, very soon, inshallah, you will enter the Masjid al-Haram. This is the ayah. لَقَدْ صَدَقَ اللَّهُ رَسُولَهُ الرُّيَا بِالْحَقِّ, verily Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had shown to His messenger the vision, the truth. لَتَدْخُلُنَّ الْمَسْجِدَ الْحَرَامِ, you will surely enter the sacred mosque, inshallah, if Allah wills. آمِنِينَ, absolutely in peace. مُحَلَّقِينَ رَوْسَكُمْ وَمُقَصِّرِينَ, getting your heads shaved or your hair cut short. لَا تَخَافُونَ, you will have to fear men. فَعَلِمَ مَا لَمْ تَعْلَمُوا, Allah knows what you didn't know. فَجَعَلَ مِن دُونِ ذَلِكَ فَتْحًا قَرِيبًا, so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has decided before that a very near victory. Next year, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and Muslims went there, and as it was settled, the pagans and the mushrikeen of Makkah, they vacated Makkah altogether. They ascended the nearby mountains. For 3 days, there were the Muslims only. No kafir. They performed the rites with full peace and calm. So before that, number one, the Treaty of Hudaybiyah was declared to be a victory. Inna fatahna laka fatah mubina. And number two, the conquest of Khaybar. This came before this Umrah. This is called Umratul Qaza. that umrah which could not be performed, and they had to open their ihram without performing umrah. Now the qaza was, you know, that was done the next year. هُوَ الَّذِي أَرْسَلَ رَسُولَهُ بِالْهُدَى وَدِينِ الْحَقِّ لِيُظْهِرَهُ عَلَى الدِّينِ كُلِّهِ. It is He, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who has sent His messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam bil-huda, with the guidance, the total guidance, the final guidance, وَدِينِ الْحَقِّ, and the true deen, the true system of justice, political, socio-economic justice, لِيُظْهِرَهُ عَلَى الدِّينِ كُلِّهِ, so that He makes it supreme over the whole of the religions. وَكَفَى بِاللَّهِ شَهِيدًا, and verily Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is sufficient as a witness and as a helper. محمد رسول الله, Muhammad, the messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَالَّذِينَ مَعَهُ, and those who are with Him, that is the companions رضي الله تعالى عنهم, أَشِدَّاءُ عَلَى الْكُفَّارِ, they are hard against the disbelievers, رُحَمَاءُ بَيْنَهُمْ, very merciful among each other, among themselves, تَرَاهُمْ رُكْعًا, you see them either bowing before Allah, sujjadan, or prostrating before Him, يَبْتَغُونَ فَضْلًا مِنَ اللَّهِ وَرِضْوَانًا, seeking the bounty from Allah and His pleasure, سِيمَاهُمْ فِي وُجُوهِهِمْ مِنْ أَثَرِ السُّجُودِ, their sign is in their faces, the effects of prostration, that is their ذَلِكَ مَسَلُهُمْ فِي التَّوْرَاتِ, this is their similitude in Torah. وَمَسَلُهُمْ فِي الْإِنْجِيلِ, as far their similitude in the Gospel, كَزَرْعٍ أَخْرَجَ شَطَهُ, like a sown corn seed that puts forth its shoot, كَزَرْعٍ أَخْرَجَ شَطَهُ فَاسْتَغْلَدَ فَاسْتَوَى عَلَى سُوقِهِ, and then strengthens it, and then it grows stout and rises straight on its stalk. يُعْجِبُ الزُّرَّاعَ, delighting the growers, so that يَغِيظَ بِهِمُ الْكُفَّارِ, so that the disbelievers may be enraged and sorrowful. Now who is the زُرَّاعَ? The زَارِع here is Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and this farm is this Sahaba Kiram, Rizwanullahi ta'ala alayhi majma'i. Now when he sees this garden, you know, there was a time when a very few people were with him. Even as I told you, 10 years after the beginning of Wahi, he couldn't have more than 125 people with him. But now, how many people are with him? So that the field, you know, is giving full harvest. And the grower, you know, he becomes delighted. وَعَدَ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ مِنْهُمْ, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has promised those who believe and do good deeds among them, مَغْفِرَةً, number one, forgiveness, and number two, وَعَجِرًا عَظِيمًا, and a very mighty reward. Suratul Hujurat, it's comparatively a smaller surah, but very profound. It discusses with the fundamentals of Islamic polity. What are the fundamentals of Islamic society, Islamic state? How to strengthen, keep it strengthened? How to avoid the schisms and conflicts? And what is the basis of membership of a Muslim society? And what's the basis of citizenship of an Islamic state? So very fundamental issues are discussed in this surah. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu la tuqaddimu bayna yaday Allahi wa rasulih. O you who believe, don't put yourself ahead of Allah and His Messenger. You have to keep behind them. They have set a limit. Don't cross the limit. Tilka hududullahi, fala ta'taduha, fala taqrabuha. Keep behind. And fear Allah, وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهُ, إِنَّ اللَّهَ سَمِيعٌ عَلِيمٌ, verily Allah is listening everything and knowing everything. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تَرْفَعُوا أَصْوَاتَكُمْ فَوْقَ صَوْتِ النَّبِيِّ, O you who believe, don't raise your voices above the Prophet's voice, because it is disrespectful. The constitutional basis of Islamic society and state is that sovereignty belongs to Allah, and the commands of Allah and Messenger will be supreme. No legislation can be done repugnant to the Quran and the Sunnah. This is the constitutional basis. But the basis of the solidarity of the Ummah, homogeneity of the Ummah, is the respect and love of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Just like, you know, a circle, the circle has a center. Center of this polity and society is Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. While the circumference of the circle, these are the commandments of Allah and His Messenger. You have to remain within this circle. If you accede, you have gone out of the pale of Islam. But to keep yourself united, homogeneous, you have to tie yourself with the center. And center is the personality of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Respect him, love him, and never be disrespectful to him, even unintentionally. لَا تَرْفَعُوا أَصْوَاتَكُمْ فَوْقَ صَوْتِ النَّبِيِّ. Don't raise your voices over the voice of the Prophet. وَلَا تَجْهَرُوا لَهُ بِالْقَوْلِ كَجَهْرِ بَعْضِكُمْ لِبَعْضٍ. And don't be loud in your speech to him as you are loud to one another. أَنْ تَحْبَتَ أَعْمَالُكُمْ. Because in this case there is a danger that all your good deeds are rendered fruitless or rewardless. This is such a big thing. Disrespect to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will deprive you of all the reward of all your deeds that you have earned up till now. Inna allazina yaghudduna aswatahum inda rasulillah. Verily those people who keep their voices low before the Messenger of Allah, ulaika allazina imtahana Allahu qulubahum lit-taqwa. They are the people whose hearts Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has tested for piety. Now taqwa will be in these hearts. لَهُمْ مَغْفِرَةٌ وَأَجْرٌ عَظِيمٌ. For them is the forgiveness and a very mighty reward. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يُنَادُونَكَ مِنْ وَرَائِ الْحُجُرَاتِ. Verily, those who come and call out for you from behind the private apartments. There was a mosque and small hujras, apartments, for the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now the Prophet is there in some hujra, maybe of Hazrat Aisha or Hazrat Hafsa, and somebody Bedouin Arab comes from outside, and he calls, "Oh Muhammad, akhruj lana, come out, I want to meet you." Now this is disrespectful. Don't do this with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Inna ladina yunadunaka min wara'i hujurat. Verily those who call out to you from behind the private apartments, aksarhum la yaqilun. Most of them don't have any sense. Because they are the Bedouins. They are coming from outside. They are the desert dwellers. They are not cultured. They are not civilized. That is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the next ayah, Allah forgives them. But in the future, they must be careful. وَلَوْ أَنَّهُمْ صَبَرُوا. If they had waited, حَتَّى تَخْرُجَ إِلَيْهِمْ. Till that time that you would have yourself come out. You, actually, it was his timetable when he is to come out, when he has to take rest. So according to your own timings, if they should have waited, that you come out yourself. لَكَانَ خَيْرًا لَهُمْ. This would have been much better for them. وَاللَّهُ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ. Allah is forgiving and merciful. Because they didn't mean the insult. But only because they were uncivilized, uncultured people, they were doing that. So there is the advice, don't do it again. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not going to bring you to the book and punish you. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا إِنْ جَاءَكُمْ فَاسِقٌ بِنَبَإٍ فَتَبَيَّنُوا. O you who believe, if some unrighteous person comes to you with a very important news, then verify it. أَنْتَ تُصِيبُوا قَوْمًا بِجَهَالَةٍ. Lest you should afflict a people in ignorance. فَتُصْبِحُوا عَلَىٰ مَا فَعَلْتُمْ نَادِمِينَ. And then you have to become remorseful on what you did. Somebody says, oh, that tribe is preparing to invade you. And you preempt and go and attack them. Because the news had come that they were preparing to attack. And then it might be that it came to the knowledge that the news, this was a rumor, wrong rumor. So what will be the result? You will be remorseful. You will be blamed. So, if some person who is very pious, dependable, if Abu Bakr brings some news, there is no need of verification. رضي الله تعالى عنه. But if some person who is not righteous, If he is bringing to you some news, then verify them before you take any step. وَعَلَمُوا أَنَّ فِيكُمْ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ. And let it be known to you that within, amongst you is the Messenger of Allah. What does it mean? He is Muhammad ibn Abdullah, ibn Abdul Muttalib, yes. But his real position is he is Muhammadur Rasulullah. Don't take him to be a man like the other men. Any Qarshi, a Qarshi like other Qarshis. A Hashmi like other Hashmites. No, no. The real position which you should keep in front of you, in your mind, always, that he is the Messenger of Allah. You know, this is very, very important. Because for Aisha radiallahu anha, Muhammad was a husband. But at the same time, he was the Messenger of Allah. She must have this position before her mind, before that position of husband and wife. In the same way, Abu Bakr was father-in-law of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. What does it mean? Muhammad was like a son to him, son-in-law. But no, 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 no. He is Rasulullah. So you keep this position of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in view. وَعَلَمُوا أَنَّ فِيكُمْ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ. It should be known to you that you have amongst you the Messenger of Allah. لَوْ يُطِيَكُمْ فِي كَثِرٍ مِنْ الْأَمْرِ لَعَنِتُّمْ. If he were to obey you in many matters, you would certainly be in trouble. Don't want that your opinion he should take. No, no. You should always wait what is his opinion. Don't force upon him your opinions. You should also wait. So that his opinion comes forward. وَلَكِنَّ اللَّهَ حَبَّبَ إِلَيْكُمِ الْإِيمَانِ. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made iman, faith, very beautiful in your hearts. وَزَيَّنَهُ فِي قُلُوبِكُمْ. He made it very beautiful. And it is endeared to you. وَكَرَّهَ إِلَيْكُمُ الْكُفْرَ وَالْفُسُوقَ وَالْإِسْيَانِ. And he has made hateful to you the disbelief, the wickedness, and the disobedience. أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الرَّاشِدُونَ. Verily, they are the rightly guided. This is the word, Rashidun, Al-Khulafa'u Rashidun, the four pious caliphs. And all the Sahaba are Rashidun. Ulaika humur Rashidun. This is about the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Fazla min Allahi wa ni'ma. And this is a bounty from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and a blessing. Wallahu alimun hakeem. He is the knower, the wise. Now another instruction. Fa'in ta'ifatani min al-mu'minin iqtatalu. If two parties, two groups from among the Muslims, mu'mins, believers, they fight with each other, anyhow, they are human beings. There can be differences, there can be conflicts, and these can go to the level of fighting. But now what is the instruction? فَأَصْلِحُوا بَيْنَهُمَا. Number one, make peace between them. No indifference. Let them settle their affairs themselves. What to me? No, 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 no. It's your duty. Make peace between them. فَإِنْ بَغَتْ إِهْدَاهُمَا عَلَى الْأُخْرَىٰ. And now if someone is doing wrong to the other, فَقَاتِلُ الَّتِي تَبْغِي. Now you have to fight against that group which is transgressing. حَتَّى تَفِيَ إِلَىٰ أَمْرِ اللَّهِ. Till it reverts to the Allah's command, to the command of Allah. فَإِذَا فَات. When it reverts, فَأَصْلِحُوا بَيْنَهُمَا بِالْعَدْلِ. Then again make a treaty between them, peace between them, with justice. وَأَقْسِطُوا. And be equitable. Surely Allah loves the equitables. إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّ الْمُقْسِطِينَ. Now this is the law, this is the rule, no indifference. If there is a conflict in the Ummah, what's the result? The total strength, collective strength of the Ummah is weakened. This Ummah has to perform the biggest mission that has been assigned to it. For that it should be strong, unified, unity, united. So whenever there is some conflict, what you say, nip the evil in the bud. Stop it here, there and then. Try to make the peace. And if somebody, some group is transgressing, then now it is not a matter between these two groups. It is as if that group is challenging the whole Ummah. Now the whole Ummah should come and fight against it. إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ إِخْوَةٌ. Verily, all the mu'mins, all the believers are brothers to each other. فَأَصْلِحُوا بَيْنَ أَخَوَيْكُمْ. So you should make peace between your two brothers. فَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ لَعَلَّكُمْ تُرْحَمُونَ. and have the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so that you should be shown mercy. Ya ayyuhallazina amanu, now there are six commandments. Don't do this, don't do this, don't do this. Three in one ayah, three in one ayah. These are the things, although they appear to be very trifles, very small things, but these things, you know, sometimes break the hearts of the people. And you know, the bond of love is broken, and some seeds of enmity are sown. What are those? Ya ayyuha allatheena aamanu la yaskhar qawmun min qawmin. Oh, you who believe, don't scoff at another people. Asa an yakunu khayran minhum. Maybe that they are better than them. You are laughing at a person, as a Muslim brother. Maybe in the eyes of Allah, he is more respectful. And you are mocking at him. Maybe he is hurt. If he is hurt, now that seed of enmity is sown in his heart. Wala nisaun min nisain. In the same way, no women should scoff at and laugh at other women. Asa yakunna khayran minhunna. They should think, just possible, that though they are better than them. وَلَا تَلْمِزُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ. Don't defame each other. وَلَا تَنَابَدُوا بِالْأَلْقَابِ. And don't revile each other with nicknames which they don't like. بِسْلِسْمُ الْفُسُوقُ بَعْدَ الْإِيمَانِ. Very evil is even, every evil is even a bad name after true faith. When you have become moments, now these things are very bad. You may say, I didn't mean it. But why did you say it? It doesn't become of a truly believing Muslim to do these things. Because they can sometimes injure the feelings of the person. And that will be a rift in the Ummah. If two Muslims, they are displeased with each other, the bond of love is weakened somehow, well, the weakness goes to the total strength of the Ummah. وَمَنْ لَمْ يَتُوبْ. Whosoever don't repent and give up these things, فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الظَّالِمُونَ. Verily then they are the evil doers. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اجْتَنِبُوا كَثِيرًا مِنَ الظَّنِّ. Now another three things. Oh, you who believe, avoid much of suspicion. Without any reason, you suspect that this person is an enemy of me. He's not a well-wisher. He is an evil-wisher for me. No. Do you have any proof? No. Inna ba'da dhanni ismun. Verily, some of the suspicions become a sin. Wala tajassasu. Don't spy on each other. Wala yaghtab ba'dukum ba'da. Don't backbite one another. أَيُحِبُّ أَحَدُكُمْ أَنْ يَأْكُلَ لَحْمَ أَخِيهِ مَيْتًا فَكَرِهْتُمُوهُ. Will any one of you like to eat the flesh of his dead brother? Now why this similitude? When your brother is dead, he can't defend himself. You can cut away any piece of flesh from his body. When a brother is not present and you are backbiting, you are saying something bad about him, he is not there, he cannot defend himself. Maybe you are wrong. Maybe the information that reached you is wrong. Maybe you were under some wrong notion and impression. Had he been present here, he could defend his honor. So there is a similarity between these two things. أَيُّهِبُّ أَحَدُكُمْ أَنْ يَأْكُلَ لَحْمَ أَخِيهِ مَيْتًا فَكَرِهْتُمُوهُ. Will any one of you like to eat the flesh of his dead brother? So this you abhor. فَكَرِهْتُمُوهُ. But backbiting, you go on doing. Although at the moral level, it's the same thing as eating the flesh of a dead brother. Inna Allah tawwab. Wattaqullah. And have fear of Allah. Verily, Allah is relenting and merciful. That is, He accepts repentances. Ya ayyuha an-nasu inna khalaqnakum min dhakarin wa unsa. Now this Muslim society and Muslim state, what is its relationship with the rest of humanity? On the two bases. Here, Ya ayyuha an-nas, note, five times in this small surah, Ya ayyuha allatheena aamanu, Ya ayyuha allatheena aamanu, Ya ayyuha allatheena aamanu, Ya ayyuha allatheena aamanu, small surah. 5 times this address, oh you who believe. But now, ya ayyuhan nas, why? Now the things which are being discussed in this ayah, they are common to all human beings, all mankind, whether they are Muslims or Kafirs. Ya ayyuhan nas, O mankind, inna khalaqnakum, we have created you all. Means zakarin or unsa, from one male and one female, Adam and Eve. وَجَعَلْنَاكُمْ شُعُوبًا وَقَبَائِلَ لِتَعَارَفُوا. And then we have made you into nations and tribes, so that you can recognize each other, know each other. He belongs to that tribe, he belongs to that tribe. When you see somebody and see, from the distance you say, he is a Chinese. Now his features are different, his color of skin is different. So you recognize him, he is Chinese. And this fellow who is coming, he is some African from some, you know, a black country, and so on. Now you have the knowledge of their background, historical background, their geographical background. All these things are with you. So all these differences that he has made in your colors, in your features, and divided you into tribes and nations, the purpose is that you should be able to recognize each other. You know, if there are two twin brothers, sometimes it becomes difficult to identify one from the other, to recognize one from the other. Had all the human beings, you know, the same, if they had the same features, the same color, absolutely equal, how could, you know, people recognize each other? إِنَّ أَكْرَمَكُمْ إِنَّ اللَّهِ أَتْقَاكُمْ. But these things are not the basis of honor and respect. Verily, the most noble and the noblest one amongst you in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who is most pious, who has the maximum fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who has the maximum regard for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who keeps within the limits of the Sharia to his maximum utmost. He is the most respectful. إِنَّ أَكْرَمَكُمْ إِنَّ اللَّهِ أَتْقَاكُمْ إِنَّ اللَّهَ عَلِيمٌ خَبِيرٌ. Verily, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows everything and he is aware of everything. Now here, let me quote H.G. Wells, who is very famous as a scientific fiction writer. He has written 2 books on the history of the world, a short history of the world and a concise history of the world. And he has criticized Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam like anything due to this polygamy, because this they can't swallow. It's a bitter pill, you know. The Westerners can't anyhow accept it. And so other things. Just like Salman Rushdie, he has criticized bitterly. But in the end of the chapter, in the concise history of the world, he quotes from the sermon of the last Hajj. لا فضل لعربي على عجمي ولا لعجمي على عربي ولا لأحمر على أسود ولا لأسود على أحمر إلا بالتقوى كلكم بنو آدم وآدم من تراب. There's no superiority for any Arab over any non-Arab. In the same way, no superiority of any non-Arab over an Arab. No superiority of some white over some black. In the same way, no superiority of any black over any white. But with taqwa, on the basis of taqwa and nothing else. Kullukum banu Adam. You are all progeny of Adam. Adam min turab. And Adam was created out of clay. And then he says, these words you must remember. Although the sermons of human fraternity, freedom and equality were said before also, we find a lot of such sermons with Jesus of Nazareth. But it must be accepted that it was Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam who for the first time in history, human history, established a society based on these principles. Human fraternity, equality, all these things, freedom. On these principles, the first ever society established in the world throughout human history was the one established by Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But there is a note of caution. You know, this note has been removed from the new edition of this book, Concise History of the World. But you can go to some older edition and find the quotation. Lest you should go and see this new edition, and then you will doubt, you know, my integrity. So you will have to refer to some older edition of the book, Concise History of the World by H.G. Wells. بارك الله لي ولكم في القرآن العظيم ونفعني وإياكم بالآيات مذكر الحكيم.
الله أكبر الله أكبر.
The Islamic Organization of North America, IONA, is an organization dedicated to reviving the Quran into the hearts of Muslims while bringing its message to non-Muslims. The obligations of a Muslim as ordained by the Quran and Sunnah can be understood as having four levels. 1. A Muslim is required to develop real faith and conviction, iman, in one's heart. 2. A Muslim is required to live a life of complete submission to the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. 3. A Muslim is required to propagate and disseminate the message of Islam to humanity as a whole. 4. A Muslim is required to try his utmost in establishing the just Islamic order. The first and foremost objective of establishing IONA is to assist the Muslims in North America to uphold and implement these obligations, first on themselves, their families, inform their friends, and then to invite the non-Muslims to Islam. The ultimate goal is to seek Allah's pleasure and salvation in the hereafter. For more information about IONA, please visit us at www.tanzeem.us. You may also email us at info@tanzeem.us or call our toll-free number 866-779-IONA. Join us. Together we can make a difference.